Developing countries often lack the essential infrastructure to help navigate global shocks like a pandemic. So they feel the impacts more acutely, and they have a harder time recovering. In our deeply connected world, that's not just a humanitarian concern. It's an economic and a security concern for all of us. We made a commitment. The democratic nations of the G7 would step up and provide financing for quality, high standard, sustainable infrastructure in developing and middle income countries. Today, we officially launched the Partnership for Global Infrastructure and Investment. It's an investment that will deliver returns for everyone, including the American people and the people of all our nations. It'll boost all of our economies. It's a chance for us to share our positive vision for the future and let communities around the world see themselves and see for themselves the concrete benefits of partnering with democracies.
The United States is the largest consumer market in the world, with a GDP of more than $20 trillion, a population of 325 million people who have the highest household spending in the world. We're also one of the most open markets in the world. We have a predictable and transparent legal system, which protects intellectual property and other rights for all companies that invest with us, not just American companies. The State Department has 200 economics and business affairs officers in Washington, D.C., and 1,500 economic officers in embassies and consulates around the world, all tasked with facilitating more foreign investment in the United States. The United States continues to work relentlessly to end the acute phase of the COVID-19 pandemic. Together with partners around the world, we launched a Global Action Plan, or GAP, to focus on and take responsibility for 6 urgent lines of effort. Those include getting more shots into arms, strengthening health supply chains, combating misinformation and disinformation. We know the world is safer and more stable when people have the chance to practice their faith freely. The State Department will continue to stand up for religious freedom worldwide and speak up about threats, attacks, discrimination, and other abuses when and wherever they occur.
NATO is emerging from this summit more united, more focused, and with more assets to deal with a multiplicity of challenges. There's not a single one. The immediate threat posed by Russia and its aggression on Ukraine and against the principles of the international order. The longer-term challenge posed by China. A whole series of transnational threats to include climate and the effect that that has, including on generating conflict. All of these things are in our strategic concept. All of these things are challenges we have to meet and face, but we know that we're going to be more effective in doing it if we actually have a shared common approach.
At this summit, we rallied our alliances to meet both the direct threats of Russia poses to Europe and the systemic challenges that China poses to a rules-based world order. And we've invited 2 new members to join NATO. It was a historic act, Finland and Sweden, 2 countries with a long tradition of neutrality and choosing to join NATO. Together, deploying more assets and capabilities to bolster our alliances across all domains, land, air, sea, cyber, and space. We've reaffirmed that our Article 5 commitment is sacred. And an attack on one is an attack on all, and we will defend every inch of NATO territory, every inch of NATO territory. At every step of this trip, we set down a marker of unity, determination, deep capabilities of the democratic nations of the world to do what need be done.